Whatever happened to the push for criminal justice reform? It was the heated cry of a sweltering summer, and New Mexico lawmakers did decide to require law enforcement across the state to wear body cameras, as you recall, but there hasn't been much other action. The Civil Rights Act has some momentum this session, so that's where we'll start. The bill would eliminate the legal doctrine known as qualified immunity as an acceptable defense. And Ed, is this a meaningful step towards reform? And maybe I'd like to get your take, short if you could, on what you think qualified immunity means and what these folks are trying to do in the differences and whether you have support or not support for that.
Yeah, a qualified immunity is a doctrine that came about, that was created by the Supreme Court, and actually was created in the late 60s. In the late 60s, it was created by then what was considered a liberal court or the Warren Court. It went through a decade or so, and then the conservative court, which I believe would be the Burger Court, stepped in and made this idea of qualified immunity a doctrine that made it very difficult for individuals to sue an agency or an individual for civil rights violations. And this is a doctrine, again, that's been decades old. And whenever we talk about reform, I think reform is sort of a big issue that communities across the country have been dealing with. Is this a reform issue? I think we want to move slowly on this idea of moving away from qualified immunity. I understand the reasons, the rationale from some of the trial lawyers for moving away from that. They talk about the justice and the opportunity to ensure that victims have some redress for any wrongs by an individual government worker or an agency, but there are already avenues in which an individual can seek redress. The concern of this is the motivations behind this reform idea. Is it really necessary? Is it the time? I think we need to go back and look at the Supreme Court's rationale in creating this doctrine in the late 60s during the civil rights. That was during the civil rights era, and then in the early 80s. And what was their rationale for it? And has that really changed? The question really remains, is there a need for the change at this particular time in the name of reform? There's so many other things that we can do in the name of reform. And this may not be one of those that gets to the top of the list. At least at this point, I think there has to be more discussion. Law enforcement has some concerns about this. And we know that some of the concerns are the motivations behind it. The way this bill is created, it'll allow for attorney fees to be awarded. And that may be the interest to many, many trial attorneys. And so the concern is it creates another avenue for lawsuits. Right. The entity that ends up holding the bag on this are taxpayers. When you look at the potential cost associated with a measure like this passing at this point.
Hey, Julianne, Ted Alcorn at the New Mexico In Depth had a really interesting piece the other day talking about how Colorado, as we all know, carved out a qualified immunity defense last year and has just now just seen its first case, a woman and her kids in a car that she thought was a stolen car. The woman and the children were pulled out of the car by gunpoint. I mean, but it has not opened this floodgate of suits in Colorado. Should we consider that the same experience for New Mexico going forward, or are they just unique up there and we're just different down here? Or any clues there?
I think it's important to look at this from a more broad perspective than just the phrase qualified immunity, which seems to be the buzzword everyone is latching onto. But what this proposed legislation is addressing are the types of cases that you can bring in federal court for violation of your constitutional rights, your civil rights. You can't bring those kinds of cases in New Mexico courts right now. And so this establishes a way for people to have New Mexico judges and New Mexico juries in the counties where the cases were brought hear these, alleged violations where the government has done something to, prevent someone from, exercising their civil rights. And that's really the point of this legislation, in an underlying way. And so, yes, it would allow people to bring litigation that they can't bring right now. And we know that litigation remains one of the most effective ways to enact change in our present civilization. And I think that for that reason, you know, the backers want this to happen.
Tom, to follow directly on Julianne's point, it's an excellent point. A lot of civil rights attorneys say that without meaningful legislative reform, it is up to the court systems to, you know, set the barometers or the barriers about what folks can do or not do. Does this ring true for you? I mean, you know, we're talking about officers, we're talking about case agents, we're not just police here. We're talking about folks who do all kinds of different governmental jobs here. So we shouldn't get too hung up on just police officers, certainly, but your sense of that we've got to have this or the courts are just going to figure it out.
Yeah, well, you just literally took all of my points, 1, 2, 3. But, you know, you bring up a great point, you know, and to what Julianne was saying as well is that, you know, everybody has the talking points going in on this particular issue. Mm-hmm. You know, the Civil Rights Act came out of the New Mexico Civil Rights Commission, who this summer was tasked to take a look at, you know, what is needed. And as a result, the New Mexico Civil Rights Act came about. Mm-hmm. The different talking points we've heard focus on qualified immunity because of the timing of the very disturbing and bad events over the summer. A police reform talking point came up. But then, you know, that's, as you stated, Gene, it is much larger, it's government reform. And, you know, to think that right now, if everybody's focused on talking points, it's usually a sign that there's something deeper going on here. And so what you really should be doing, I think, is really putting the brakes on this particular piece of legislation just to get everything fleshed out. And when the legislature reconvenes in December to address redistricting, then bring this and put this on the call as well to really address so we can get this issue taken care of once and for all.
Tom, I got to ask, is that one kick of the can too many, though? We did do that once previously.
Yeah. You could make an argument either way. You know, it just seems as if right now that there's too much concern out there. I think that people are making the case that perhaps slowing down and addressing it within this year. I'm not suggesting multiple years or anything like that, or even a special session in July, would be a good place. But I think right now there's just enough miscommunication and misperception about what this what the issues are, one, and two, what the ramifications are, that it's worth just slowing down just a bit.
Ed, let me ask you this. We've seen a couple lawmakers, Mo Maestas and Stuart Engel particularly, talking about changing licensing processes, which is now the job of a Law Enforcement Academy board, of course. What's your sense of that? That seems like, I'm not quite sure where they're getting, where they're going with that, but is that the solution here? Is that better for, as you see it?
Based upon my understanding on why Representative Maestas wants to do this is because in its current state, it's moving slow, that this process is really a slow process and it's not as efficient that I think they'd like to be. Recently, there was a report that there was such a backlog of the right. types of hearings for police officer conduct. And my understanding of this bill is that if we move it into an area or a department who deals with these types of issues and so many other licensing areas that they can create a greater efficiency. Mm-hmm. Is that the best place for it? Well, I think it's probably six of one, half a dozen of the others. I think it comes down to efficiency as a reason for trying to move this.
But Ed, are they on to something though about the better training? Is there something there that they're talking about?
Absolutely. I mean, training is the key. And for those who are hearing and making decisions on these cases, what is the most appropriate place for these to be heard? I haven't seen a major problem. And it may be one of those things, if it ain't broke, as they say, don't fix it.
Right.
But the position is maybe this is broke. And so we don't want to throw out the baby with the bathwater. Maybe we take a look at what's working, where it's currently at, and try to fix some of those issues of concern before we move. Either one of the places, I think, will serve a purpose. But is it necessary? I guess that's the question.
Good point there. Julianne, one last for you. You wrote last summer in the Santa Fe Reporter that Senator Peter Wirth expected a, quote, omnibus police reform bill this session. He was quoted a few places with that. What happened? Why didn't that happen?
You know, I really don't have any insight into that. But I can say that, you know, the topics of police reform have been attempted to be addressed in a variety of ways this session, and not a lot of them are seeing traction. You know, the reporter is still suing the city of Santa Fe over transparency in police discipline records. Our mayor doesn't think that the city ought to know whether police are doing their jobs or whether they're being disciplined when they don't do their jobs. There was a legislative attempt to address this that I don't think is going anywhere. You know, you mentioned the body cam legislation that passed last session, and we haven't seen anything that's quite that crisp in this session. So I think police reform is something that's going to continue to be debated at our roundhouse long into the future.
I agree. All right, we're out of time on that already. Thanks to you all. I'll be back in a moment with a few final thoughts.